Haltessiagaming. Okay. Salutations, fam. This is Dark Slayer Arim from Haltessiagaming. And in today's video, I'm going to be doing a bit of a two-parter type thing. Over the last like week and like I guess week and a half or so, I've been playing the control build. I've gone undefeated with it at several events. It's been doing very, very well. So this is going to be like slash deck profile, but more so I kind of want to like answer a lot of questions about like the deck in general and like talk about like, so it's going to be like a deck profiling a lecture video. So it's going to be like probably going to end up being like pretty long. So I'm just letting y'all know about that. So you know what you're sitting in for. So anyway, this is the deck list. Very, very similar to the last deck profile, but there are some like minute changes that I really do think like impacted the deck list like significantly. And that is the wrong ban list. We're in the TCG. But yeah, 3 Blue Eyes White Dragon, 3 Jet. I took out Alternative and played 3 Blue Eyes because Alternative wasn't really that impactful. It's like, it's a free special of a 3K body in a deck that special summons 3K bodies all the time. And the only reason why we were playing Alternative is to enable Alternative Ultimate Dragon being able to pop 3 cards. But like, you can still pop cards with this. It still can't be targeted or destroyed by card effects. It's still, the things about this card that make it game-winningly strong are still there with all Alternative. It's just a little tiny bit less broken, you know? And it's actually a lot more accessible, because the thing about Alternative is that you actually have to fuse Alternative from the field or the graveyard. You can't fuse it from the hand. And that actually does come up sometimes. But as I said in the last deck profile, this card was just like so stupid. So I did end up bumping this up to 3 copies per deck. If you saw the community post where I posted a screenshot from like the tournament yesterday I was playing at, where I actually managed to get all 3 copies of it on the board. Like, it was so funny. But yeah, this card is like, it's so insane. Like, it's basically just DPE, if I'm gonna be real. Like, it's DPE, but like in the sense that it just keeps coming back every turn. It's just like, this helps you so much in regards to like outgrinding opponents and things like that. I'll come back to this a little bit more, but like finishing up the deck profile, we got 3 copies of Stone of Ancients, 1 Ecclesia, 3 copies of Pot of Extravagance. Pot of Greed is really strong. I've seen a lot of people say like they don't like this card, and I'll tell you why you don't like this card. Because you were playing control decks wrong. You were trying to play a combo deck. This is not a combo deck. This is a control deck. Like, Pot of Greed says draw 2 cards. It says free +1 and card advantage. This is not a combo deck. Like, you need to be playing Pot of Extravagance. You need to be playing a smaller, you know, number of options in your extra deck. Don't try to fit like the combo extra deck in here. You're being greedy. It's not gonna be good. Play like an extra deck. Play Pot of Extravagance. It'll serve you way better. Stop being greedy. That's, you know, you're playing top starting to play a combo deck when you're playing control. 3 Dragon Ravine. This is your, you know, one card. Put any Blue Eyes monster on the board every single turn. 3 Ultimate Fusion. Because we're playing Bingo Machine Go. Bingo Machine Go gives you much more consistent access to like all your Blue Eyes engine, because you can, you know, search Ultimate Fusion, Jet, or Blue Eyes White Dragon, or True Light. And the speaking of True Light, you can set Bingo off of True Light during your turn and then search any of these cards. So in addition to being able to like set Ultimate Fusion during your opponent's turn, you can set Bingo during your turn to get access to a Jet or a Blue Eyes or whatever you need to like kind of get your stuff in rotation. 2 copies of Fusion Deployment. This just says summon Blue Eyes White Dragon directly from the deck. 2 copies of Nadir. One of the things that I realized that, because you know, a lot of people have been asking me questions about the deck. One of the things I realized is people don't realize that this is starter for your Blue Eyes engine. The Dogmatica cards give you your Blue Eyes engine because you're playing Chimera Felicia. You send this to the graveyard off of your Dogmatica cards, and then this searches Fusion Deployment. What does Fusion Deployment do again? It summons Blue Eyes directly from the deck. So Nadir and Punishment are starters for your Blue Eyes engine. Okay, so remember that. Obviously, True Light, this summons your Blue Eyes turn after turn over and over and over again. It's what helps you stay in the grind game. But I'll come back to this and talk a bit more. 3 copies of Gozen, 2 Skill Drain. I only own 2 Skill Drain. You would reverse the ratios on this. You would play 3 Skill Drain, 2 Gozen. Gozen is very game-winningly strong, but every single time I've won the game with Gozen, Skill Drain also would have won me the game, except very, very, very specifically the Eldritch matchup, and like specifically like Trap Eldritch. That's like the only matchup where Gozen is better than Skill Drain, because with that matchup specifically, with the Heavenly Prison or whatever, right? If they summon that and you can like clear the other monster, Gozen match can lock them out of the Eldritch stuff. So it's like they can't summon the Golden Lord, they can't summon their trap card. So they're just kind of locked out of those if you can like put them on just a Heavenly Prison and also like the Link monsters. But even then, like if you flip this, they're only locked into Eldritch stuff. They can't go into Heavenly Prison. They can't go into the like the extra deck monsters or things like that. So yeah, but still 3 Skill Drain, 2 Gozen. Well, actually, because you should build for the meta that you're playing. And if you're playing in like a very heavy Eldritch meta and everyone's playing like Monkey Flip, then yeah, sure, play 3 Gozen. But based off of like what is currently like meta in like the tournament scenes, I would recommend 3 Skill Drain, 2 Gozen. Anyway, moving on, 2 copies of Dogmatica Punishment. Honestly, you could play one of this because, you know, you have more access to it with the Nadirs and the Ecclesia. But I just like having that second one, because sometimes you draw and you want to still be able to search. I'll come back to that point a little bit later. 3 copies of Infinite Impermanence. This is your hand trap, but more importantly, it's a powerful trap card for you to reset off of Tyrant Dragon. It's monster effect negation. This is also spell trap negation. You got to remember that part. In the Eldritch matchup, this card is actually one of the most important cards in the deck. This is how you stop them from IDPing you. This is how you stop them from using Hot Quero, because remember, they're usually going to be setting a lot of cards from the deck. So you hold this, and then when they set like the IDP off of the Heavenly Prison, you then set your Imperm in that column so that when they try to IDP, you can flip up Imperm, target the Heavenly Prison, and negate the IDP, or do the same thing and negate the Hot Quero. This card is very, very impactful in that matchup, and it's like a lot of people forget about that second effect, and it's very relevant. 3 copies of the Tenyi Counter Trap. I've had some people say that like they play Solemn Strike and things like that because, you know, Solemn Strike is always live, whereas this is not. The reason I play this isn't because it's just a counter trap. It's because it's specifically a counter trap that synergizes with the engine, but also it has value going second into common boards. Things like the Sword Soul board where they have Blackout, things like DPE. The thing that sets this card apart is the fact that if it gets destroyed, it floats into a Blue Eyes monster, Blue Eyes Ultimate Dragon. That is an important thing to remember about this card versus something like Solemn Strike. If you draw Solemn Strike going second into a Sword Soul board, it's just going to get popped and you're not going to have anything. Vice versa, if you have this on the other hand, you're going to at least have a Blue Eyes Ultimate Dragon, and that does matter a lot in certain matchups. That 4,500 body comes up. It's a lot of times, like, if they don't have specifically the removal, and a lot of times they won't because they just reuse their removal to out your back row, they're usually going to have to like wait a turn to get access to removal to then be able to out the Blue Eyes Ultimate Dragon. And that single turn that it holds, that it buys you, can be the difference. And obviously, if you have like multiple copies of this and they pop it, this will then make the other copies of this live. That interaction going second, that's the big thing, is the interaction going second. I just realized something about the art for this. Is that the Charmer? No, never mind. I thought it was like the Charmers off of like Unpossessed, but I think that's Shaman. I think that's the Wind and the Water Tenyis, and that's like a Monk. Anyway, back on topic. Extra deck, we have the 1 Blue Eyes Ultimate Dragon to summon off the counter trap. 2 copies of Alternative Ultimate Dragon. This is very powerful in control matchups. You summon this. It's very easy to summon this, actually, because, you know, you have Dragon Ring, you have Fusion Deployment. You just kind of, like, bend 3 Blue Eyes and then, like, summon this. And then, like, a lot of decks, because it can't be targeted or destroyed by card effects, and because it's so, you know, it's 4,500, a lot of decks just can't deal with it. Most specifically the control decks, anyway. And then you have the 1 Neo Ultimate. This is a punishment target that also happens to be able to be sent off of Nadir in punishment. And also, again, relevant that this is a Blue Eyes monster, because if they target this to like try and out it, you can negate and destroy the card with Neo Blue Eyes Ultimate. That actually does come up sometimes. And then also, this is a dragon, so that helps you get your dragons into the grave to be able to summon Tyrant Dragon. On the note, 3 copies of Tyrant Dragon, this is like the boss monster of your extra deck. This is a card you're trying to summon most of the time. You know, unaffected by traps, reset your trap, can attack everything, it's relevant. You can use other copies of this to make this, so you can just kind of loop your tyrants between each other with Ultimate Fusion. 2 copies of Elder Entity Entis. It pops a card on the field. It's the IDS matchup is super easy in this match, and like with this deck, it's like one of the easiest matchups in the metagame, simply because they are not allowed to use the most powerful card in their Dogmatica engine, and if they do, they just kind of lose the game, because you just send Entis Rafflesia, and not only do you get to go Entis, target Mechaba, and force that card out, you, on your turn, you get to trigger the Rafflesia and either add Fusion Deployment if you don't have your engine already, or Ultimate Fusion to be able to get access to Tyrant Dragon. It's just like, that's really strong. I mean, it's a big part of why, like, you know, I don't think I've lost a game to IDS, like, in the last, like, 2 weeks. And I've played against it a lot. Like, I have not lost a game just simply because either A, they're not using Maximus, which means their, like, setup is just significantly weaker, or they are using Maximus, and, well, they're losing the game because of that interaction. And then also, like, even if you don't send these, like, having access to, like, Wind Pegasus and, like, Neo Ultimate and, like, Faergie, you have a lot of different cards that you can send off of Punishment, Nadir, Maximus, that, like, will just completely switch the game into your favor. Chimera Felicia, as I said, this searches Ultimate Fusion and Fusion Deployment. Wind Pegasus, if they pop one of your cards or destroy it, you get to, like, target a card and shuffle back. And this is relevant because, so the thing is, if they destroy one of your monsters by battle and you trigger this, this is activating in the damage step. So that's something to remember. Because actually that came up one time where someone, like, hit over a Blue Eyes, and then I was, like, chain link one, I think I was, like, chain link, I can't remember, I think it was, like, chain link one Jet, chain link two Wind Pegasus, to, like, chain block Ghost Spell. And then I, like, targeted the DPE to shuffle back the DPE, and they couldn't chain the DPE because it was happening in damage step. And then, you know, we special back the Jet, and, you know, like, and then we shuffle back the DPE. The DPE's gone, like, because they're not playing multiple copies of Celestial and Dasher. Like, if they're doing all that, then, like, you know, they got it. But anyway, also moving on, we have the one Faergie. So the reason why I'm playing the Faergie is because sometimes I do want a Mulligan. It's like, the thing about this deck is that every card in the deck is good. I do want to draw every single card in the deck. Like, I'm not unhappy seeing any of these cards, but sometimes I have, like, multiple of a card that I won't need multiple of. Like, maybe I have, like, two extras, or, like, two Skill Drain or something, or, like, two Punishment. Being able to, like, Nadir, send Faergie, and then, like, mulligan off one of those cards that I don't necessarily need right at that moment, you know, that's something I did kind of like, and I just like having that extra versatility. And then obviously the 3-link Karibo. Somebody suggested, like, 2-link Karibo and 1 Relinquished Anima. I do like that. Like, it's fine, because the main thing is just being able to, like, link off the stone, because, you know, that gives you access to 3 extra starters, because right now you have 14 cards in your deck that give you access to Blue Eyes Engine. But yeah, 3-link Karibo. And the main thing about it is that if you have 1-link Karibo, you have infinite Link Karibo, because you can start summoning it from the graveyard in future turns. Onto the extra deck, we have the first card in every single one of my side decks for the last 3 years, Pankratops. And then we have Triple Nib, Triple Lancia, Triple Phantasmate. This card's really good, this format. A lot of decks do Link Summon, and having that hand sculpting, the mulligan, in control matchup, that targeting and the gate is actually very relevant. And just in general, like, going plus. Remember, you're playing a control deck, you want to just constantly go plus. This guard can help dig you into, like, these cards, dig you into, like, your floodgates, dig you into your board breakers and things like that. 3 copies of Dimensional Barrier. This card is just so game-winningly strong against, like, the matchups that it's good against, and being able to go D-Barrier, cough, whatever their mechanic is, attack with Tyrant, and then reset it and just do that every turn. It's just, like, it's basically just, like, they're not playing through it. And then 2 copies of Paleozoic Dinomiscus. Again, this is just, you know, for back row, and, like, Eldritch and things like that. The main thing about this deck is that, like, I'm not siding very heavily for back row matchups, because it's just, like, I have 3 Ultimate Fusion in the main, and, like Tyrant says, unaffected by trap cards. So, like, I don't really need to, like, side very heavy for back row, because my main deck is just already strong against back row. And, you know, obviously back row is not, like, a common matchup. But that's going to be it for, like, the deck profile portion of the deck. So now I'm going to talk a bit more about, like, just, like, the mindset and theory behind, like, playing, like, this deck and, like, playing control decks in general, because, like, if you're a combo player and then you just switch to this deck, like, you're going to have trouble with this if you don't know how to play control. Because a lot of people have, like, this misconception that, like, control decks are about, like, just flooding your opponent out of the game. That is not how you play control deck. Playing a control deck is about resource management and situational awareness. Those are, like, the 2 most important things you need to have when you're playing a control deck. yes, you do want to like see floodgates, but the reality is that you're not going to see floodgates all the time. The thing about playing a combo deck is that, yeah, you are going to want to use all of your resources turn one, build your unbreakable board, and lock them out of the game. You cannot do that with a control deck. If you try to like burn through all your resources as quickly as possible, you're going to lose. Because the thing about control decks is that it's not about locking them out of the game completely turn one. It's about limiting them enough that they can't kill you, and then doing that every single turn until they run out of resources and you snowball them out of the game. The thing about like a combo deck is that you have to know how to play your deck. With a control deck, you have to know how to play the opponent's deck. You have to know their choke points, because you're going to have a limited number of interruptions. Because the thing is that trap cards don't replace themselves. Trap cards don't give you board presence. It doesn't matter if you have Skill Drain, Gozen, TCBU, Rivalry, Summon Limit, if you don't have any monsters, because then they're just going to poke you to death and you're going to lose the game. And it's like, I've seen a lot of people, like, when they make their adjustments to the deck, they'll, like, take these out. They'll take, they're, like, you know, change the floodgate lineup. You know, they'll, like, you know, play more floodgates. They'll, like, change things. They'll play more back row. But it's like, that's not what you're trying to do with a control deck. You're trying to outvalue your opponent in card advantage. And the thing about the floodgates is that you're just playing them to help facilitate that. The thing about this is that, and also just in general, like, you have to know when to use your cards. That's like the most important thing about like playing a control deck, is knowing when to do things. If you are doing things when you don't need to do them, you're going to lose the game, because you're putting yourself in a situation where you're burning through your resources unnecessarily. And again, like, a control deck is about resource management. And adding on to that topic of like resource management, one of the common misconceptions is that it's like about knowing about like your resources and using your resources. It's also about managing your opponent's resources, understanding what their possible plays are, what their choke points are, what they have left in the tank. I played at the tournament I was at yesterday, I played against an Eldritch player, and like I won, you know, the matchup pretty dominantly because I was managing my resources better than him, and I was managing his resources better than he was, you know? Like, for example, like he, so basically I, like as I showed in like the community post thing, I had the thing where I had like three Jet Dragons on the board, and he flipped up Skill Drain, and like that turns him off, but it's like, that only turns off half of them. That only turns off the half of them that preventing you from popping my stuff. But the thing about it is, if I have three Jet Dragons in rotation, I don't really care if you're able to like kill them now, because they're just gonna keep coming back from the graveyard. And like, you know, I'm able to use like Imperm to stop like IDPs, and like True Light to stop IDP on like Blue Eyes for Dragon. Like if you go IDP target Blue Eyes, I can go chain True Light special Blue Eyes, you know? I can go chain Ultimate Fusion to use away the Blue Eyes. And the thing, you know, talking more about like True Light, for example, a lot of people will just like flip up True Light. If you don't need to do that, don't flip up True Light. You know, there's no need to like burn through your resources. Yes, the sooner you flip up True Light, the sooner you're going to be able to like start setting stuff from the deck, start like special summoning more monsters. But if you don't need to do that, don't do it. You know, you're playing control deck, you're going to try, you need to try to outvalue your opponent. You don't want to be using resources before you need to use them. Just because your opponent is summoning monsters and using effects doesn't mean you flip up the Skill Drain yet. You know, don't flip up the Skill Drain on the first effect. Let them commit to their board, let them commit their resources, and then when they do the thing that's actually like threatening you, then flip up that Skill Drain, because now they burn through a lot of their resources and now they have to play under this Skill Drain. You know, same thing with like Gozen. You don't always flip it up as soon as they have two monsters with different attributes on the board. Sometimes you do want to let your opponent play, and in order to do this, you do have to be mindful of what your opponent's resources are, what they're trying to do. You know, I remember, you know, like this was like, you know, like last year, I think, you know, I was playing Dragon Link against like a Dragoon Eldritch player, right? He had Dragoon plus 5 back row, and I was playing Dragon Link, and I was able to play through his board and like win the game. And he had like Solemn Judgment, Torrential, Dragoon, Gozen match, right? And like I was playing against, you know, one of our best Dragon Link players, and I only had Imperm Ash, and I was able to shut down his turn completely. Right? Why is it that like, you know, when I'm playing Dragon Link, I'm playing against this Dragoon Eldritch player, why am I able to win? Does it mean that like Dragon Link's the best deck, you know, in the game or anything like that? I mean, yeah, Dragon Link is the best deck in the game, but that's for a different reason. But but the thing about it is that, like, me being, you know, in the situation where I'm playing Dragon Link, I know my deck better than he does, and I know his deck better than he does. He doesn't know my deck and my choke points as well, so he's not using his resources at the most opportune moment. He's just kind of like using cards on things and kind of hoping it stops my turn. You can't really do that in a control deck. It's not going to be able to get you success. You have to actually like know what the choke points are. You have to know that, oh, if my opponent is doing this thing, these are the potential options that they have. Like, you have to know this stuff if you want to be able to see success with a control deck. You have to know how to play, you know, the base deck. You have to know how to play the Dragon Link deck. You have to know how to play Prank Kids and Virtual. You have to know what their options are. You know, when I was playing against the Dragon Link deck, I have Imperm Ass, so I already know, okay, my opponent has made the Striker Dragon, and he's activated the effect of Striker Dragon. What does that tell me? That tells me he doesn't have Boot Sector Launch, which means that if I imperm this, he doesn't have access to Boot Sector Launch. So in order for him to keep going, he has to have Quick Launch. He has to have two extenders, basically, because he has to have access to Tracer and a card to pop with Tracer. No, he actually has to have three. He has to have access to another monster to be able to link off into the seal, and then access to a Tracer, and then access to a card to pop with Tracer to go into the Chaos Ruler plays. And obviously, because, you know, he was the best player in the game, he had all of that. But the thing is, I still ended up winning the game, because what he ended up doing was, he ended up making Quad Boreal Dragon, then used the effect, brought back the Tracer, and then he activated Tracer effect, targeting, I can't remember what it was targeting, but he targeted something, and basically what this situation tells me is that, like, so basically at this point, I've already used the Imperm on the Striker Dragon earlier in the turn, and I have just the Ash. So him summoning the Quad Boreal in this situation, he has no more cards in hand, he doesn't have access to Boot Sector Launch, he's activated Quad Boreal, he summoned Quad Boreal, and activated the effect. So what does this mean? He can't go into any Link to a Lower Monster, so he can't go into Hieratic Seal. Because he's used Tracer effect, he's locked, you know, into Darks. So basically what this means, that if I stop this Tracer here, there is no possible play that he can make that will allow him to keep playing. He's going to end on no interruption. And I'm not going to be able to do that unless I know his deck in and out, you know, as well. Like, I would have to know, you know, his options and things like that to know what my individual interruptions cut off. And, you know, and because I know that, I'm able to use the Imperm at like the perfect, you know, moment to be able to shut it down, to be able to know if you are making this specific play in this specific order, these are the potential follow-up lines, and ask myself, okay, well, if your hand is three extenders, you are probably playing through everything I was going to do anyway, and, you know, stopping the play there, right? And it's just like, the reality is that, you know, sometimes they're just the best player in the game and they just drew like the perfect five card in. Like, sometimes it happens, you know? But it's just like understanding like when to do things. Just because you can flip up the back row doesn't mean you should flip up the back row, even if it is a floodgate, you know? Understanding when to do things. Because remember, once you flip up that floodgate, they know you have the floodgate and they're playing around the floodgate for the rest of the game. The longer you keep your back row hidden, the longer you have the advantage of your opponent not knowing what they have to deal with. And that's like, you know, one of the things. And like, again, like when you use your back row, because trap cards don't natively replace themselves, you know, when you use the punishment, that punishment is just gone. You don't have any, like, you're not going to have that resource going into the next turn. When you flip up that Imperm, you're not going to have that resource going into the next turn. You know, you need to be able to like understand, you know, when to use it. That's why you also shouldn't like load up the deck with, you know, like interruptions, because it doesn't matter if you stop your opponent if you can't capitalize on the fact that you stopped your opponent. You need to be able to know when to do stuff. You need to be able to be aware of how many resources your opponent has gone through. Things like, okay, how many cards do they have left in hand? Have they used their normal summon yet? Have they done something that like locks them into something? You know, things like that. For example, like with Dragon Link, Tracer locks them into Darks. So if they've used Tracer effect, that means they can't go into Opelousa. That means they can't go into Hieratic Seal. They can't go into Halky Fibrax. They can't go into Baron Nayflor, like, if they've used Tracer Effect. They can't, they're locked out of those resources. So it's important for you to know about things like that. If they've used Quad Broil Effect, they cannot summon Link 2 or lower monsters. So that cuts off Hauki Firebrax, that cuts off Hieratic Seal, that cuts off Striker Dragon, that cuts off Gardevoir Elpie, that cuts off the Charmer Links, you know? Understanding, like, with the Eldritch deck, you know, if they've activated and resolved, you know, an Elixir, they can only summon zombies. So that means if they go and they use like a Scarlet Sanguine, they can't use IDP anymore, you know? They can't use the Heavenly Prison to special summon anymore, you know? If they have a Cursed Eldland on the board, they can't attack with anything but zombies. So if they have that on the board and they're going into like the Access Code OTK, that's fine because they can't attack, you know? Being aware of things like that so you know when you actually do need to use your interruptions, because if they're doing something not realizing that they're like locked out of something, they're, or maybe like they do realize they're locked out of something, they're trying to get you to waste their interruption before they commit to the play that they're actually trying to go into, you know. I remember probably one of the best examples of this was I was playing you know, my Shadal deck, right? I was having to deal with a Zeus and I had 1600 life points left. Right, I cannot activate Verte Anaconda. I make Verte Anaconda and I go anything on summon. I can't activate Verte Anaconda. This is a bait. My opponent has a Zeus. The life point counter with Neuron is literally right there. So if he looks over there and sees that I can't activate Verte, this entire place falls through. But he didn't. And so he activated Zeus, he wiped the board. And I'm like, cool. And then I play, keep playing, and I'm able to win the game because that Verte Anaconda play, even though it wasn't going to go anywhere, he used his resources unnecessarily. So because he used his resources unnecessarily, I was able to play through and win in a situation I wouldn't have normally been able to. And that's the thing about a lot of control decks. A lot of players use their resources when they don't have to. Just because they are doing something doesn't mean it's actually a threat to you. It doesn't matter if my opponent summons four monsters if I have Skill Drain and Jet Dragon in rotation, you know? It doesn't matter because it's like, if they are able to summon a monster, well, my monsters are just gonna keep floating, you know? And in reality, there's really just not that many monsters that can hit over 3k bodies under Skill Drain, you know? So it's like, just be mindful of, you know, your resource management and be mindful of what resources your opponent has access to. So you're not just burning through stuff unnecessarily. And that whole concept of like managing resources and card advantage is what will win you the game in a control deck, is why cards like Pot of Extravagance are so impactful, because they just immediately give you card advantage. They immediately give you more resources to play with. It's why I'm side decking Phantasmic, because being able to just go plus one like that is very impactful. And honestly, in some matchup, Phantasmic itself is pretty strong, you know? Having the ability to like negate a targeted effect is pretty strong, because like if I have like Jet Dragon Phantasme, it's suddenly significantly harder for my opponent to deal with my board, because let's say they have something that can target the like let's say they have Unicorn, for example. Being able to negate the Unicorn with, you know, Phantasme, so, and then like them not being able to use something like their destruction effects, because they have to target, well, they don't have to target Jet with destruction effect, but if they target anything else, it just doesn't do anything. So they're going to target Jet Dragon, and having something that can, like, that extra thing that can protect the Jet Dragon is, like, really impactful, you know? And just in general, that draw two, I can't tell you how many times I've won the game because, like, the draw two drew me into exactly what I needed, you know? And, like, fixed, like, a kind of like wacky hand. And the thing is, like, yeah, you can play Phantasme and Extrath because they don't conflict with each other, because this is going to draw you cards on your opponent's turn, and then on the follow-up turn you get to Extrath and draw two more cards, and then you're like massively plus in a deck that is all about going plus in card advantage, or like breaking even and just like outvaluing your opponent. And but yeah, I don't know how long I've been talking in this video or how long it's been like gone to. But yeah, just in general, that's like something I wanted to like kind of like talk about, is I really want you guys to remember, like, if you're playing a control deck, you have to remember how important it is to manage your resource. You gotta really hold your you know, your resource for as long as you possibly can. You know, it doesn't matter if they get to play a little bit, you know? It doesn't matter if they get to play a little bit if they don't get the payoff for it. And sometimes, even if they do, you know? Sometimes, yeah, you really can just kind of wait until they make that Verte and they go Verte effect, and then you flip up the skill drain. Because, you know, at this point, they've committed their entire resources, their entire board, and suddenly, everything just got turned off. They've used all their resource, they paid that 2,000, they have no gas left, you know? Sometimes, yeah, you want to wait until they pay everything off, and then you just flip that card and you just completely shut them out of the game, you know? You know, like, skill drain, like, especially because it's like, you don't want to, like, and it's also important to, like, know, like, when that sweet spot is, because if you wait too long, then you're suddenly in a situation where, like, they've summoned DPE and then you're flipping up skill drain, they just chain DPE and pop the skill drain, you know? So it's like, it's important to, like, understand, like, oh, basically, like, knowing, like, when is the last possible moment that I can flip up my card and, you know, have it be impactful, you know? Like, if my opponent is summoning, like, Levianeer, for example, at that point, yeah, you kind of, or, like, Banishing Lights and Dark, at that point, yeah, you do kind of have to flip up your skill drain, because if you don't, they're going to pop the, you know, skill drain with Levianeer, you know? But, yeah, that was just something I wanted to, like, kind of talk about, because I felt it was something that wasn't really, like, clicking for a lot of people. A lot of people have been telling me, like, they've been having trouble in certain matchups, and, like, every time, like, I think to myself, like, really? How? Like, we win that matchup for free, but it's just, like, I realize, and this is just something that, like, I do kind of forget sometimes, is that, like, I have literally been playing the game for 20 years at this point. You know, I have, like, literally, like, I have, you know, decades of competitive tournament Yu-Gi-Oh! Experience, you know, like, and it's like, a lot of things are not common knowledge, and it's just like, it's easy to forget that something isn't common knowledge. So it's like, never feel bad if you have to, if it's not clicking immediately, just ask the questions, you know, I'll happily answer the questions. That is something I do want to, like, kind of talk about real quick, is that, like, because, you know, I've noticed, like, you know, a lot of people, when they, like, send me DMs on Twitter, my Twitter's in the description, by the way. If you ever, like, have questions or whatever, my Twitter's in the description. So, yeah, send me questions. I'll typically get to them if I see it or whatever. But a lot of times people will, like, apologize for, like, asking me a bunch of questions. And it's just, like, you should never feel bad about wanting to learn, you know, learn about stuff. Like, you can't know something until you learn about it. That's just how it works. You know? And this doesn't make you, like, stupid or anything because you don't know stuff. It's just, like, everyone has to learn something eventually. Everyone has to learn at their own pace. But, yeah, that's basically what I wanted to cover in this video. This has been Dark Slayer Arim from Haltessiagaming. Again, I'm almost at that 4K watch hour. Please help me out. Leave my videos on in the background. Help me get there. Share it with your friends and everything like that. Yeah, like, comment on the videos and everything. It helps, you know, get my videos in the algorithm and all that. Like and subscribe, turn the notification bell on, like, all that good stuff. Help me out. I'm almost there. I am almost there. But yeah, and if you're feeling really jelly, feeling really generous, I do have my, donation link in the description as well. Because I'd definitely be playing some weird lists. But yeah, that's basically all the shilling out of the way. But yeah, this has been Dark Slayer Arim from Haltessiagaming. Thank you very much for watching, and you guys have yourself a wonderful day. Go drink some water. I always have trouble with this thing. It's not. It's the return of the button.